Good morning, everybody. Let's stand together, worship the Lord together. I'm glad you're here, and I'm glad you're here.
Exciting day for a lot of different reasons. Pastor Bethay is preaching for us this morning. Hayden is preaching this afternoon. We have a baby dedication. I'm glad that they just now showed up. Everyone, okay. We'll get them up here in a few minutes. But it is exciting to follow God. It really is exciting to respond to the voice of the Spirit of God. Let's pray for our service. Lord, it is an exciting thing to just be in your house. And there are many, many people all over Spartanburg. They're at other places, and they are having maybe a good time, but there's nothing like being in God's house with God's people. And so thank you for this privilege. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for what we get to hear from the Word of God. And I pray, Lord, even now that you would help our hearts to be open, to be sensitive. Lord, give us what we need. And I pray that we would worship you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
My faith has found a resting place.
I must tell. Lord, I hope you're pleased. Precious Lord, take my hand.
Few guests that are here with us. It's good to have Natasha, and Natasha, I think, stepped out, and also her daughter. Remind me of your name. Nice to have you. Thank you. This is Paris's family. So Paris has been here for a while, and wonderful to have you. And then Elizabeth Humphrey's mom and sister taking care of the Humphrey kids so that mom and dad could be away. And so it's good to have you all. Thank you for being here. Anyone else here for the very first time? Did I miss anybody? All right. Just a few announcements. Happy birthday to Miss Bales, and that is Friday, right? Happy birthday to you. We mentioned Pastor Pathé will be preaching this morning, so we're so blessed to be able to hear him. And then this afternoon, Hayden will be starting his sermon series. If you remember, Ryan was helpful in his preaching several weeks ago. And so Hayden has three more Sundays, and then he's off to college again. And so he will be preaching on Psalm 23. And hope you can be here this afternoon for that message. Lunch and discipleship and connect groups right after the morning service. Hope you can stay for that. And then Chase for Victory this Wednesday. Brother Mike Pelletier will be here for the next two Wednesdays. His topic is victory over bitterness or victory with forgiveness. And just a reminder, sometimes we might hear a topic like that and we say, well, I'm not bitter, so I'm not coming. Well, you still have to come, all right? No, you don't have to come, but remember our theme is helping others with the word this summer. And so I would encourage you to come and to take notes, and maybe God would help you with forgiveness or with bitterness, or it could be that you take some notes and God would bring someone in your life, maybe even in this next month or so, that struggling with bitterness, that you could use those notes and the things that we'll be learning to help counsel that individual. We do need just a little bit more help for our activity for the teenagers. That's this Saturday at 4:30. It's a yellow yak activity. And so if you could let me know if you would like to be involved in that, it's not hard. I can give you all of the details. That's going to be at Haywood Mall, and we'll meet at our house for riding the van at 4:30. We do have baptism and Lord's Supper coming up. It's on the same day, baptism in the morning service, and then Lord's Supper in the afternoon. That's on August 20th. And so if you know somebody that needs to get baptized, they've trusted Christ as their Savior, and they're ready to follow the Lord in this very important step of obedience, that you could talk to me. Actually, today would be good because we're going to be doing that in discipleship time. Connect group will be talking to those that are ready to be baptized. All right, guys, you can come, and we will take our offering. Hunter, if you could pray for the offering for us.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day, and thank you that we get to come and worship you. I pray for the sermon today that will be a blessing to our heart, and that will be encouraged and challenged by it. I pray for this offering that you bless it and use it. And in your name I pray, amen.
Almost look exactly alike. Have you noticed that one? I wonder why. Hallelujah. Jesus saves. Amen.
Thank you. commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever block me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Amen. Thank you.
All right. Well, we are excited to have our baby dedication. And so I'm going to ask Michael and Caitlin to come on with Claire Victoria. The bad thing about this is I remember when these two were in elementary school, and that's sad. And I haven't gotten any older, but apparently everybody else around me is. So we're thankful to have family as well. Grandpa Bethay is here, and Uncle JB, and we got the Tan family here. Where's the Dr. and Mrs. Tan? Do they? Oh, there's Mama Tan. Grandpa Tan. Please refer him to him as Grandpa Tan from now on. And Aunt Yvonne and Aunt Ann. And anybody else? Yes. Extended family. Yeah, welcome. And we'll hold you all accountable as well. We are so thankful for this family, and God's blessing is on you all. And I wanted to read this verse, Psalm 127, verse 3. It says, "Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward." And you know this, and in your heart you know that God has blessed you with little Claire Victoria. And we have been learning, as we have gone through the book of Colossians, that the blessing of the Lord brings great responsibility. And this is not in any way making sure that this child gets saved, and this is not going to help this child get saved, other than we want to pray as a church for Claire Victoria. And we want to pray for these parents and this couple, and to bring up Claire in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, to be the right kind of dad, the right kind of mom, based upon the scripture, and as we've been learning, to be the right kind of husband and wife. It's different when a little one comes in, and when you do your fighting, you can't do it in front of the little one. You know what I mean? It's everything's different now, and but all of that makes a difference. And so today we're dedicating little Claire Victoria to the Lord. And our prayer is that she would trust Christ at an early age, at an age that she won't go back in doubt, and also that she would surrender her life and God would use her in a powerful way. And then we're also dedicating and really praying for mom and dad as well, that God would allow them to depend upon the grace of God and to use them to be the right kind of parents. And we'll pray for grandparents and family members as well. And God will use grandparents, won't he? And God will use aunts and uncles and other extended families. And so we're excited. And I'm going to, it's okay if I hold Claire Victoria?
Yes, you know.
Okay.
When's the last time she had a diaper change?
An hour?
Okay. You know, a couple things. One is I held Claire Victoria before Grandpa Bethay did. And can you imagine? Well, he was sick, okay? So he was sick for a few weeks. And one thing we probably should pray about is that I'm anticipating a big issue when these three girls, 13 years from now, in the youth group, with Ellie and Izzy and Claire, because this one has the most hair. And if it keeps trending like that, and the other two don't have hair, and this one has hair in the youth group, that's going to be an issue. And so we should probably pray about that. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for this blessing. Thank you for Claire. And Lord, we do pray, just as we just talked about, we want Claire to get saved at an early age, at an age that she won't go back in doubt. Lord, that she would learn to walk with you, and that she would be surrendered to you. And Lord, I pray for Michael and Caitlin. I pray that you would help them to walk with you. Help them be the right kind of dad and mom, husband and wife. And I pray for the extended family as well. I pray for grandparents and aunts and uncles. And I pray that you'd use them to instill a godly influence into this life. and to thank you, Lord. This is a blessing from you. We honor you for that, and we praise you, and we dedicate now Little Claire to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
All right, she wants to eat, and I can help with that. So.
I got a gift for you,
Claire, and normally it looks like a giveaway.
All right, we are thankful to have Pastor Bethay come preach, and he's going to come preach to us right after the special music.
Thank you, ladies. Matthew chapter 3, please hold off on that first screen, if you will, just a minute. I want to ask a question first. Matthew chapter 3, while you're turning there, this is not a hard question. I want you to think of your favorite Bible character, all right? Think of your favorite Bible character. Got it? I'm going to count to three. I want you to say it out loud, like you mean it, all right? Favorite Bible character, count to three. And it's always confusing. Do we go on three or do we go? So I'll go one, two, three, boom. And then you tell me, okay? Ready? Got it? One, two, three. Go ahead and put my screen up. I didn't hear John the Baptist, but that's... maybe he'll go higher up your list after today. That's the goal. Move him a little higher up the list today, but... If I preached on your favorite Bible character, it would probably be a multi-series. It might take me a year or so, those of you that know me. So that's probably one of the reasons why I picked John the Baptist, because there's not a ton written. Matthew chapter 3, if you're there, I'd like to read through the passage, get a general idea, 30,000 foot kind of look at it, and then just pick out a few things that we can take away from the message this morning from the life of John the Baptist. Okay, Matthew chapter 3, and we'll start in verse 1. In those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, The voice of one crying in the wilderness, Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to the baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance. And think not to say within yourselves, We have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you, that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And also, the axe is laid under the root of the trees. Therefore every tree which bringeth not forth fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. I baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat under the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, Suffer it be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Father, I thank you so much for the living word of God. It is impeccable, Lord, without error. And I pray today that you might use it as a fire and as a hammer in our lives to help us to understand better who you are and who we should be before you and for you. Thank you for our time together today, fellowship and around the word in Jesus' name. Amen. John the Baptizer, he was an interesting sort of guy. I think there are some things, I love Bible characters, and I would like to have picked a character that more has been written. I mean, Daniel, there's Joseph, there's Peter. I love Peter. Peter, I think I identify most with Peter because he was always doing and saying the wrong thing. But one of the things that I like a lot about Bible characters in general is that almost all of them in Scripture, there are obvious flaws that are written in the Bible for us to see. And it just encourages me to know that God can take a crooked stick and draw a straight line with it. And that you can be a flawed human being. You can be someone who fails of the grace of God. You can be someone who stumbles, who doesn't get it right all the time, who frequently fails, who fails in cycles over and over again, and can come back to the Lord and make it right and get forgiveness and still be a tool in the hand of God Almighty, the righteous and pure one. You can still serve. You can still live for Him. You can still love Him. You can still influence other people. And the fact is, none of us can measure up to Him, and He knows that. And so that's one of the reasons why I like Bible characters in general. John, I think, is interesting in a lot of ways. And so I just think there are three timeless principles we can take away from John's life this morning, and I can do it quickly. So first thing we have is the meaning of life. The meaning of life. I think that it's true with John, and it's also true with us, that all of us have a general purpose for living as a Christian, and I'm talking about Christians now. There's a general purpose, excuse me, and then there's a specific purpose. And what I mean by that is, all of us are supposed to obey the Ten Commandments, right? Okay, that's general purpose, right? You woke up this morning, you came to church, you're a Christian, and so you have a general purpose. Your general purpose in life is to do the right thing. We all have that. We all share that. But I believe that you also have a very specific purpose in life, beyond the general purpose. Thank you, appreciate it. Yeah, I think this is the problem. I swallowed it a little bit down the wrong pipe there. When you get old, you do weird stuff. You do all kind of weird stuff. Hair grows out of your ears. You choke. You can't talk. All kind of weird things happen when you get old. Yep. So we all have this general purpose, you know, greatest commandment, 10 commandments, greatest commandment. What's the greatest commandment? What are the greatest commandments? Go ahead and shout it out. You can participate with me this morning. What's the greatest commandment? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself, right? Summarized, right? Colloquial way of saying it. That's general life, general specifics, or general requirements for all Christians. But what about you? Let me ask you this question. Why is it that you are different from everybody else in this room? Why is that? Why is that? Why is it that you are unique today? I mean, God's the one that made you. He created you, right? And I believe that God gave you everything that you need to do everything that God intends for you to do. But the question this morning is, are we doing it? I think a lot of Christians, most Christians really probably, are satisfied with the general purpose in life, and they're not looking for and seeking to fulfill God's specific purpose for them in their life. It enables you to be a kind of a Christian spectator. You can just kind of watch other Christians Christ. You know, you can just kind of, you kind of observe, you kind of sit on the sidelines and watch the game of Christianity and church and so forth. And you can just observe and you feel good about yourself because you keep the general purpose of Christianity, the general purpose of life. But what about the specific purpose? I mean yours. I mean, there's not anybody in this room today that does not have a specific purpose of some kind that God created you for. And do you know what it is? Or are you after it? Are you seeking it? And willing to fulfill that specific purpose in life? John had a very, very specific purpose. And this is one of the things we see in Matthew chapter 3, verse 3. It says, "For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight." It's a prophecy from Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, and also from Malachi chapter 3. John was a Nazarite. He took the Nazarite vow, which was, among other things, to not let a razor come to your hair. Diet was very strict, so forth, so on. They were people that separated themselves for the purpose of special kind of dedication to the Lord. It's interesting. Maybe you, how many of you have heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls? Dead Sea Scrolls. Do you realize they were found in a cave in Qumran in 1947? So very, very, very late discovery of the, and a Bedouin shepherd, a guy out tending his sheep, had a goat, got away, walks in and stumbles upon a cave, and inside the cave are these jars, which he didn't know what they were. He takes them into the market and tries to sell them. Come to find out, they're some of the most ancient scrolls of all scripture from the first century. Amazing. I mean, it's been called the greatest archaeological discovery ever. John, that's where he was. John was part of the Essenes, which were the people that lived in those Qumran caves near Jordan River. And they were scribes. They were scholars and scribes. And they took themselves out of society and they went to a private area, kind of a place, and they gave themselves, they dedicated themselves to the specific idea of really learning about the Lord. John was a little different from most of them. They were very, very exclusive. John was inclusive. John had a message. John had a specific purpose, and his specific purpose was to make straight the path of the Lord, to prepare the way for Jesus Christ, the Messiah. He's very, very specific. And so we see this, and it made me think of Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. You've heard the prophet Jeremiah. In chapter 1, verse 5, interesting passage. chapter 1, verse 5 says, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. Before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet unto the nations." So Jeremiah had a ministry and a mission before he was ever born. So did John. It's interesting, when Elizabeth, John's mother, was expecting, her kinswoman is how it says it in Scripture, cousins probably, but her cousin Mary I don't know that she knew she was expecting at the time, but she visits Elizabeth, and Elizabeth's baby leaps in the womb with joy. John the Baptist is jumping inside of his mother's belly because Jesus' mother came for a visit. I mean, it doesn't get any earlier than that, right? Before you have a mission, a specific purpose, right? And I don't think that's unusual. When we read it in Scripture, it's kind of unusual. You know, when you think of Bible characters, you think of these people that had these very specific ministries, missions, assignments, and so forth and so on. But I don't think it's any different for you or for me. I don't think it's any different. Now, what God intends for us may not be what He intended for John the Baptist, right? We might not be big shots, but we're shots. I mean, not everybody can be the president, right? Not everybody can be the one who influences thousands or millions of people, but you can influence your neighbor. You can influence your family. Everybody has a specific purpose, and I think this is one of the important things that we take from the life of John the Baptist in the meaning of life, is that there is a general meaning. But don't be satisfied with that. Don't be satisfied just with being a law keeper, just being a good person, just being somebody who would, you know, if you compare ourselves among ourselves, which the Bible says not to do, but if we were to compare ourselves among ourselves, we'd say, hey, I'm pretty good compared to everybody else. I'm a pretty good Christian. That's not good enough. No, there's a specific purpose. You're unique for a reason. Figure out what it is and get busy about it, right? And then secondly, there's the message of life. In Matthew chapter 3, verse 2, the Bible says, "And saying," this was his message, "repent ye," that's what he said, "for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." That's why he said it. There's an urgent situation out there for everybody who is alive. And it was the same in John's day as it is in our day. Do you realize, and I know many of you do, that the most urgent need you have as a living, breathing human being is to repent of your sins and accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. You may say, I need more money. I need food. I need shelter. No. What you need is the knowledge that you will go to heaven when you die. That's what you need. That is the most urgent need that every living, breathing human being has. And this was the message of John. He carried the most urgent message there is on the planet. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. When you read some of the passage, you see two things that become clear. First thing is there's only one judge. In other words, who's going to decide how good you are? You ever thought about that? I mean, when you're growing up, when you're a kid, you know, you think it's your mom and dad are the ones who are deciding how good you are. Or how bad you are, and what's going to happen as a result of being bad. You know, your mom and your dad are kind of your judge. You know, teachers, you know, kind of judge, and the policeman might be your judge. You know, from time to time. There's only one judge when it pertains to what happens to you after you die. There's not, we live in a world where there are all kinds of ideas about life after this life. You know, there's all kinds of cults and various things. There's the Seventh-day Adventist and Jehovah's False Witnesses and on and on and on the list goes of all these people that have their own ideas about what happens to you after you die. I wouldn't want to be Jehovah's False Witness. The reason why is because only 144,000 of them are getting to heaven. And it's been around a long time. I'm pretty sure already 144,000 have already made it. So everybody that's coming along now, how good do you have to be to knock somebody off that's already on the list? And if you don't make it, guess what happens to you when you die? Guess what they believe that happens to you after you die if you're not 144,000? It's annihilation. You just gone. Disappear. No afterlife. No living forever. No nothing. Man, I wouldn't want to be that. But it's the kind of thing, and it's typical of everything other than Christianity, in that it urges you, it pushes you towards being good. You being in control of the outcome. Let me tell you something. John's message was, none of us are in control of the outcome. God alone is the gatekeeper of the kingdom of heaven. My brother-in-law and sister-in-law, they live in a gated community in Greenville, and I can never remember the gate code, never. I can't. I go there all the time, and I have to call him every time. So, what's the gate code? I sometimes try to find it in about a million text messages because it's in there like 10 times. I can never. It's a four-digit code. Come on. How hard can that be? But I can't remember it. So I sit there at the gate waiting on the gate code. Because there's only one code that's going to open that gate. Sometimes I actually wait on somebody else that knows the gate code to go in before me and I go in behind them. But that tears apart the illustration. Just totally debunks the illustration. So I'm sitting there and the gate is not going to open without the proper code, right? There's only one way the gate opens to the kingdom of heaven. And it's the message of John. Repent. The word repent means to turn around, to change your mind. It has a lot of nuances of meaning. But for me, the idea is this. We have all kinds of ideas as to what's right and wrong, good and bad, what's fair about how you get to heaven, you know, what the sense of fairness that we have. You know, well if I'm better than that person is, I mean, I should have a chance. And certainly the thief on the cross would never have gotten there, would he? If it was fair, he had no opportunity to come down off the cross and live a better life, a good life, or even be baptized for that matter. And yet the Lord said to him, today you're going to be with me in paradise. You know why? Because it's a decision of faith. He abandoned his ideas about good and bad, right and wrong, evil, and he trusted the one hanging on the tree beside him. You are God. I believe that you are God. I believe you're able to save my soul and take me to paradise with you when you go today, later. And that is what it took. That was the gate code. Not baptism. The gate code's not getting dunked underwater. That doesn't. You get dunked underwater all you want and the gate won't open because you got dunked underwater. You can be the best person that humanity has ever known. You can be the greatest human being that the world has ever known and stand at the gate of heaven. Without repentance, it doesn't swing open. You don't have the code. And this was the message of John. It's a simple, simple message. There's only one path and there's only one judge. That's it. So here's what the passage says. Let's read it together, beginning of verse 7. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, who are they? They're religionists. These are the good people, all right? The church people. The good people. The kind of people that everybody, you know, they themselves thought they were good. All the people in town thought they were good because they go to church every Sunday. They give money. They serve. They do all the good things. And so these good people are coming to John. They come to his baptism and they said unto him, and he said unto them rather, not nice. And this is one of the things I like about John. He talks kind of like I think, you know. You bunch of vipers, you snakes. Wait a minute, you're talking to the good people, right? Oh, generation of vipers. Who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance. In other words, all your good works and all your church going and all your fancy robes and your phylacteries that you wear on your head and all your moaning and groaning about how good you are, that isn't the gate code. Who warned you? And then he says, why don't you do the right thing so that the gate will open? Bring forth therefore meat for repentance and think not to say within yourself. He's a mind reader. Did you catch that? Don't think within yourselves, hey, we're Abraham's kids. Let me tell you something. It doesn't matter who your mom and your dad are, how religious they are, how good they are, how much the Lord loves them or they love the Lord. The gate swings open on your code, not theirs. God can take these stones and make Abraham's kids. They thought that he's saying, don't you dare think that because you came from religious heritage or you have this tradition that is what gets you into the kingdom of heaven. Only one thing does. There's only one path and there's only one judge. And the judge says the path to kingdom of heaven is repentance. Don't hear that preached on a whole lot these days, do you? For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children of Abraham. And now also the axe is laid at the root of the trees. Therefore every tree which bringeth forth not good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. God's the one swinging the axe, my friends. We've got all this religious growth, right? All this religious show, all this religious example, all this churchianity everywhere. And God's just going to take His axe of His word and hack it right down. And then He's going to put it to the test of fire and it's not going to pass the test. This is what it says. I indeed baptize you with water. Unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. You see the difference between a true servant of the Lord and someone who is religious. One is puffed up with pride, and the other is as low as humility can take someone. And this is one of the reasons why I really love John the Baptist, because of his humility. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, which is a symbol of judgment, by the way. And then I love verse 12, because it gives another illustration of God as the judge, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat under the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. You remember the parable that Jesus taught about the wheat and the tares? Tares is darnel. It's a weed that looks a lot like wheat in the early stages, but it doesn't bear a profitable seed head like wheat does. And so the Lord said in his parable, just go ahead and let the tares grow up with the wheat, because we'll sort it out at harvest time, right? When we harvest it, we'll take it in and we'll let it dry. And we'll take the winnowing fan and we'll toss all of it up into the air, right? And the wheat, which has got weight to it, it's profitable, you can eat it. It will fall back to the floor. But all the unprofitable parts of the plant, the stem and the leaf and the weeds and all that, the fan will blow all that away. And then once we're done with all of that, all that we're going to have in front of us is wheat. And then we're going to have this big pile of trash. And we're going to stick a match to it and watch how quickly it burns. That's the difference between repentance, following the one path that satisfies the one judge, and doing it your way. Your thoughts, your sense of fairness, your idea about, well, if I was God, you know, this is who I'd let in. A newsflash, you're not. You're not. So this represents how the gate swings open. And this was the message of John. This was the message of John. There's one judge. One judge. And, you know, it's interesting. I remember one time I was a member at a golf course for a short period of time years ago, and I would go out by myself on purpose, had tracks in my bag, and I'd get hooked up with people that I didn't know, play golf with them, and witness to them. And I was with this one guy, and we had played 16 holes. And for 16 holes, he had used language that I rarely hear. It was a display of vile humanity. And on the 16th tee, he asked me if I knew where he might find some adult entertainment that evening. And I said, you know, I don't. I said, I'm a Baptist preacher. I just don't know where those places are. I apologize. Well, he nearly had a heart attack on the tee. And for the next three holes, the rest of the way in, he went on to try to convince me how good of a person he was. He realized he had blown it for 3 hours, and he spent the last 30 minutes trying to fix it. And when we got done, shook hands, I said, you know, you don't have to convince me of anything, because you know what? I'm not your judge. Where you go or what you do or how you live or what you think, you'll never stand before me and account for any of it. You don't have to apologize to me. You don't have to explain anything to me or apologize to me, because I'm never going to hold you accountable for it. But the God of heaven is. He is. He's the one with the fan. He's the one with the axe that comes down at the root. He's the one with the unquenchable fire that will test you. He's the one you should be concerned about right now. Not that you've offended me. This is the message of John. There's one path, there's one judge. Jesus, when he was getting ready to leave, he was trying to prepare his disciples for his departure. He was only in public ministry three years or so. And so, really, really incredibly brief amount of time of public ministry. And he's trying to get the disciples ready for the fact that he's leaving soon. He's only 33 and a half years old. They've left everything to follow him. They've left their jobs. They've left everything. They've committed themselves to following him. They've seen him heal disease and cast out demons. And it's all just starting. It's all just starting. And they're now totally committed, and they've bought into everything. And then in John chapter 13, he says, I'm leaving soon. They're confused. We're just getting started. You should do this until you're 65. What do you mean you're leaving? I've got to leave so I can go and prepare a place for you and come back and get you and take you to that place. And then he says something to them, because this is the real part of the preparation, because he's leaving and he is entrusting to them the stewardship of the very gospel. Which, how scary is that? That the Messiah would leave the responsibility of the gospel with people. But he did, and he does today. And he wants to be very clear that they understand what that gospel is. And so he says to them in chapter 14, verse 6, I am the way, the path, the road. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then the next statement was exclusive of every other way to get there. No man comes to the Father but by me. That was their message. That was the message of John. That was the message Jesus passed on to the disciples. There's just one judge, and there's just one path to satisfy that judge. And as John says it, it's repentance. And then finally this morning we see his manner of life. It was simple. His appearance was simple. It was dictated by his Nazarite vow. But if you ever look up any pictures of John, usually you'll see a muscular guy, probably because of the way he talked, you know, your generation of vipers. I don't know, but they depict him as being kind of muscular. He's wearing camel hair, garment of skin. He's eating bugs. My kind of guy, eating bugs. Living among the tombs, of the caves of the Qumran area, the Jordan River, and with the Essenes, probably, and very much like them, but yet one distinct difference, he's inclusive where they're exclusive. He wants everybody to repent. He wants everybody to have the gate code. So he leaves the sanctuary of the Qumran caves, the Essene area, the scholarship, the scribal copying of the scriptures, and so forth and so on. He leaves that and he goes out into the wilderness and he's preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He's taking the message that they're securing. They're understanding, they're learning, they're writing, they're copying. He's preaching. Everybody has a specific purpose. John's fulfilling his, but he's a simple guy who's taken a Nazarite vow. Verse 4 says, and the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locust and wild honey. It was a simple life and it was a focused life. John wasn't distracted by earthly things, boats and motorcycles and lake houses and nice clothes and makeup and, well, I probably shouldn't have said that. My bad. Went somewhere I shouldn't go. The simple, timeless message that addressed the most urgent need. He was fearless. He was not intimidated by the religiosity of the day. He was true to his Nazarite vow. Notice what it says in John chapter 1, verse 19. This is the record of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you? Who are you?" Verse 20. And he confessed and denied not, but confessed. First thing out of his mouth when he was asked, who are you? He didn't tell them who he was. You know what he did? He told them who he wasn't. He said, I'm not Christ. I'm not the Christ. Verse 21, and they asked him, what then? Art thou Elias? And he saith, I am not. Art thou a prophet? And he answered, no. Then said they unto him, who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou of thyself? What do you say of yourself? Be a question we could all ask ourselves this morning. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah in chapter 40, before he was born. You know what he said? I am who the prophet said I was supposed to be. A person who makes the path of the Messiah straight. I'm the forerunner of Christ. I'm his helper. I'm the one who is paving the way for the Messiah of the Old Testament, just like the prophet said I was supposed to be. Verse 24, and they which were sent were of the Pharisees, and they asked him and said unto him, why baptizest thou then, if thou be not the Christ, nor Elias, neither a prophet? John answered them, saying, I baptize with water. But there standeth one among you whom you know not. He it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoes I'm not worthy to unloose. These things were done in Bethabara beyond Jordan where John was baptized. And the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, and I love this. This is one of the reasons why John the Baptist is way up on my list. Because he's make no mistake about it. John the Baptist at this point is a bit of a celebrity. He's got quite a following. He's popular as a preacher. But when he sees Jesus, do you know what he says? Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. John the Baptist never wanted anybody thinking he was more than what he was. He always, 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 with his life, with his words, with everything about his life that's recorded in Scripture, he always pointed to Jesus Christ as the answer and the solution. Always. It's one of the things I really love about him. is that humility and that understanding. Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. Now, he wasn't before him physically, but he was there when the foundations of the earth were laid. It's a statement of the fact that Jesus Christ, who is among you now, who you see, is the Lamb of God. He is the God of all creation. He is the pre-existing God. It was a statement of the Godhead of Jesus Christ. For me, the greatest mark of Christianity, the greatest mark of Christianity, if you're going to judge somebody, then to me, the thing that has carries the most weight with whether somebody's the real deal or not is humility. You look at Isaiah chapter 6. What happened with Isaiah when he saw the Lord? When he saw the Lord, he saw himself. And then he saw others. That's the way it works. I used to say, I have a message. It's not a very good message. If it was, I probably would have preached it today. But the title of it is, the closer you get to God, the farther you realize you are from Him. The more you see the true nature of God Almighty, the more you see yourself as being so inferior, so low, so worthless, so such a nobody. When you see God, you see yourself more accurately. People that are arrogant, that are full of themselves, that think they know everything, I don't think they've seen much of God. John wasn't like that. And then we have timeless takeaways. I promised Guy Harris I'd end early because his hip's hurting. So, timeless takeaways. Four things quickly. Don't be a spectator. Fulfill your purpose. All right. All it is just a rehearsal of what we just talked about. Don't be a Christian spectator. Don't be a spectator. Don't be satisfied with this general idea of living the Christian life. Be specific. Fulfill your specific reason for being here. Number two, don't be good, be forgiven. Don't be good. Nobody's good but God. But you can be forgiven. You can repent. You can know what it is to have a new heart given to you by the Lord Jesus Christ. He paid the requirement that God had for sin and offers a blood-stained hand to each of us in salvation if we will but take it. But some try to get there without His help. The gate won't open. Thirdly, don't be distracted by life on earth. John was certainly, and I don't know that everybody is called to a life of asceticism like John was. I don't know that. I don't think that. He certainly was. But isn't it kind of interesting? Doesn't it kind of make you jealous? Somebody like him that lives in the desert, off the earth, and just minimalist, you know? Just doesn't need anything here because he's living his life for what comes later. He's fully invested in the life after this life and not distracted by the one here. I'm jealous of that. I'm jealous of that. And then finally, the closer you are to God, the farther away He seems, or the way I've said it there is the thing I love about John, and that is his, he doesn't care about John. Paul said it this way, he must increase, I must decrease. John was good at that. John was good at increasing the Lamb of God and decreasing John. What a tremendous life that we have in Scripture for us to take a look at for a few minutes this morning and evaluate his life and his message and to be able to take those things and apply them to our life and how we might be better for the Lord. Father, thank you for our time together this morning. Thank you for the words that are recorded around John the Baptist and truly a special person. There's no question about that. But I also believe, Lord, that everyone here is special in the sense that you've created them and given each of us a specific purpose in life that should be fulfilled for your honor and your glory. And we pray these things, Lord, that you'd help us to do that in your name. Amen.
As we close today, could we just have our heads bowed and eyes closed? I want to ask, there may be someone here that is good. I think the church is probably filled with good people, but maybe you've never been forgiven. In other words, you never trusted Jesus Christ as your own personal Savior. You know, the gate code is not a number, it's a person. His name is Jesus, and Jesus will forgive you if you simply trust Him. And I just want to ask, is there someone here that's just being honest, and you say, you know, if I were to drop dead right now, I'm not sure that my sins are forgiven. I'm not sure that I have a home in heaven. I've never been saved, never been born again, never trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior. If that's true about you, would you just simply just put your hand in the air just so that I can see it, and then you can put it right back down? You say, pray for me. I'm not sure that I'm saved. Just slip it up, and then you can put it right back down. I'm not sure that I'm saved. Christian, God has used Pastor Bethay to remind us of some important things, not to be spectators, not to have distractions in our lives, and the importance of humility. And let's pray and ask God to help us with these things. Hayden's going to play, and let's talk to God about what He talked to us about. Maybe there's something very, very specific God dealt with you about, maybe just a reminder. God has used the preaching of the Word of God, used the Word of God and the Spirit of God to challenge us on these issues. Thank you for the preaching of the Word of God this morning. And Lord, I do pray that if there's someone here that is not sure that they're on their way to heaven, I do pray that you would continue to work in their heart, work in their life, convict them, and may they understand that Jesus is the only way, that they can trust Jesus as their Savior. And thank you for these reminders, these truths that we needed to hear. And thank you again for the privilege, the opportunity that we have to come into a place like this and to hear the Word of God and to be able to respond. Thank you, Lord, for the food that we're about to eat. Pray you bless it to our bodies and bless now the discipleship time, the connect group time, and the afternoon service as well. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You are dismissed.